What is the most devastating volcanic eruption in history? Maybe volcanoes like Mount St. Helens, Krakatau or Mount Vesuvius come to mind. After all, there's a reason why these names are remembered till today, decades, centuries and even millennia after their most famous eruptions. The eruption of Mount St. Helens, for instance, killed over 50 people and caused over $1 billion in damages. Mount Vesuvius famously killed at least 1,000 people from Pompeii and three other Roman cities. And the catastrophic eruption of Krakatau killed at least 36,000 people. But there are, of course, volcanic eruptions that are still considerably worse. Supervolcanoes, like the one beneath Yellowstone National Park, for instance, which last erupted 630,000 years ago. This eruption was, in terms of material ejected, around 50 times larger than Krakatau. But even that is minuscule compared to what our planet is capable of at its worst. This is a flood basalt eruption. Even though their name might not suggest it, they are the largest and most devastating lava eruptions in history. Eruptions so massive, they have again and again changed life on this planet in a way and on a scale like no other natural phenomenon. To understand how enormous these eruptions were and what impact they had on Earth and its inhabitants, we have to go on a journey into the deep past. Let me take you back in time 250 million years, to the late Permian period, roughly 10 million years before the appearance of the first dinosaurs. At that time, all continental plates were fused into one gigantic supercontinent, called Pangaea. The conditions during this time weren't unlike today's. The Earth recently had come out of an ice age, and the South Pole was still covered in ice sheets. Over the last couple million years, the climate had slowly but steadily warmed, and giant desert areas had begun to form in the center of the continent. Nevertheless, much of the temperate regions were still covered in huge conifer and fern forests that presented a wide variety of lush environments for life to exist. Even more than that, life flourished and diversified, resulting in a wide range of new plant and animal species. The rulers of this era were the therapsids, mammal-like reptiles that had, over the course of the Permian, developed into the dominant life form on the planet. Among them were giant predators such as Gorgonopsians, a family of carnivorous therapsids that were characterized by their long saber-toothed like canines and could reach a size comparable to that of lions or tigers, as well as a wide variety of large, medium and small herbivores. This was also the time when the first cynodonts appeared, the group of therapsids that would eventually give rise to the first true mammals, some 50 million years later. Amphibians and other reptiles were present too in these forests, but they were slowly getting relegated to the sidelines. But that would soon change. In the oceans, life was able to develop similarly unhindered. Even though the formation of the supercontinent had resulted in a drop of sea levels and the loss of continental shelf regions, what remained of shallow coastal waters presented an ideal habitat for small and large life forms alike. This is the scene of the biggest natural disaster in history. A key event that would alter the planet on such a scale, it would forever change the course of evolution. And it began here, in the north of the supercontinent, in an area that would later become today's Siberia. Around 250 million years ago, an unimaginable amount of molten rock, risen from inside the Earth, had accumulated directly beneath the Earth's crust and was now, at various points, beginning to make its way to the surface. The widespread release of gas from the ground, major and continuous earthquakes, as well as an uprising of the crust by several hundred meters, was signs of the impending catastrophe. It probably started in the northwest of Siberia, in the Tunguska Basin, near today's city of Norilsk. Over an area of more than 100,000 square kilometers, 40,000 square miles, a vast network of volcanic vents began to open, producing huge pyroclastic and phreatomagmatic eruptions with fire fountains 30 kilometers or 20 miles high and spreading enormous quantities of gas, molten rock and ash across the lands, which quickly turned a region the size of France into a hell on earth. But these weren't your typical volcanic eruptions. These eruptions were fed by a gigantic bubble of magma beneath the crust, with a diameter of maybe 1,000 kilometers or 600 miles. And through the countless rifts and vents that had opened up, this magma now began to spread across Earth's surface. Quickly, the emerging lava masses flooded vast areas of today's Siberia with layers of molten basaltic rock up to 50 meters or 160 feet high. a seemingly endless reservoir of magma meant that each individual lava flow continued for more than 100 years, burying the land under up to 2000 cubic kilometers or 500 cubic miles of molten rock. Additionally, over the centuries and millennia, ever new rifts and vents meant that the magma continued to leak onto the surface for close to 350,000 years. And so, layer by layer, the masses of lava were not only spread over a huge area, but also built up to enormous heights. As if the giant lava floods weren't enough, gases like sulfur dioxide, chlorine and fluorine, released in vast quantities by the enormous eruptions, caused devastation even hundreds of kilometers away. Basaltic rock is especially rich in sulfur dioxide. When released into the atmosphere, it reacts with water vapor in the air to form sunlight-blocking aerosols. These aerosols can for months, sometimes years, result in a significant temperature decrease, a volcanic winter. Acid rain, the result of the condensation of hydrogen chloride and hydrogen fluoride, can cause burns and poisoning in plants and animals that come into contact with it. Additionally, fluorine and chlorine can cause damage to the ozone layer, potentially exposing vast areas to dangerous UV radiation that can cause tumors and gene defects. Although all these gases are typically removed from the atmosphere rather quickly, the prolonged nature of the volcanic eruptions in Siberia meant the destructive potential of them was constantly renewed. When the lava flows eventually stopped, the floods had buried an area of more than 4 million square kilometers or 1.5 million square miles, so an area half the size of the United States, under a layer of lava more than 2 kilometers or 1 mile thick. But despite the incredible destruction this catastrophe had caused in the north of the supercontinent over the past 300,000 years, the rest of Pangaea as well as the oceans were relatively unaffected by it. But that would soon change. Because what, on the face of it, looked like the end of the large-scale volcanism in Siberia was only the beginning of a second, much more catastrophic phase, which was looming hidden beneath the now solidified masses of lava. The trillions and trillions of tons of volcanic rock that were now bearing down on the Earth's crust acted as a giant lid that prevented more of the still abundant magma inside the ground to rise up to the surface. With no way up, the magma instead began to force its way laterally into the rock, creating a huge network of sheet-like horizontal intrusions, so-called sills. This network began to heat up an enormous area of continental crust, like a giant underfloor heating system. As the hot magma came into contact with the volatile rich sediment of Permian Siberia, vast quantities of organic and inorganic CO2 were freed from the rocks. Additionally, the destruction of pre-existing oil and coal-bearing deposits by the sill intrusions released even more gases. When the sills eventually reached the boundaries of the lava province and found their way to the surface, these gases were released all at once in one catastrophic pulse. Maybe up to 100,000 gigatons of CO2 got released into the atmosphere. This had far-reaching consequences for the climate, which this time weren't limited to the northern hemisphere, the entire planet was affected. Almost instantly, the global average temperature rose by 5 degrees centigrade, or 9 degrees Fahrenheit, the result of catastrophic global warming. Compared to the daily, weekly, and seasonal temperature variations we experience constantly, 5 degrees might not sound that much, but yearly global averages are a much bigger deal. During the last ice age, when much of North America and Europe were buried under more than a kilometer of ice, the global average temperature was only about 5 degrees centigrade lower than it is now. So you can imagine what consequences a jump of 5 degrees in the other direction must have had. And this was only the beginning, as the warming of the oceans soon would set off a chain reaction that would raise temperatures by another 5 to 10 degrees centigrade or 18 degrees Fahrenheit, through the release of oceanic methane. At the bottom of the oceans, along the continental slopes, there exist immense reserves of frozen methane, so-called methane hydrate. This methane was produced by tiny microbes as a metabolic byproduct over millions of years and was then, at depth of over 200 meters or 650 feet, frozen into ice crystals through high pressure and low temperatures. That way, it is stored stably and safely for long times. It is, however, very responsive to changes in the environment, particularly to changes in temperature. And so, 250 million years ago, as the result of the warming of the oceans, vast quantities of methane got released into the atmosphere as big portions of the methane hydrate deposits melted. Like CO2, methane is a greenhouse gas. Its effect in the atmosphere are, however, 30 to 86 times stronger. And so, the planet subsequently warmed another 5 to 10 degrees, to a total of 15 degrees centigrade, or 27 degrees Fahrenheit. This cataclysmic temperature increase transformed the planet from a lush paradise into a barren hellscape. Imagine the northern United States or the UK at temperatures like the Sahara, or tropical ocean temperatures of over 40 degrees centigrade or 104 degrees Fahrenheit. Because of this intense heat, most of the plant life perished, the large temperate forests all but disappeared, and the desert areas that before had only existed in the center of Pangaea began to spread across the entire continent, killing everything that wasn't adapted for life in such harsh conditions. The few animals that did survive were small generalists that could survive on little water and weren't too picky about their food. Many of them were only able to survive these extreme temperatures because they lived in underground burrows. Our ancestors, the cynodonts, were one of these few survivors. The ocean was affected even worse. The enormous amounts of CO2 in the atmosphere resulted in a similar increase in oceanic CO2. As a consequence, the pH level of the water dropped and the ocean acidified. This made building exoskeletons, shells, or other calcium carbonate structures increasingly difficult, making animals that need these structures to survive, like corals, zooplankton, or shellfish, the first major victims of the crisis. At the same time, the ocean began to lose its oxygen. Warmer water can hold fewer gases than colder water, so large-scale ocean anoxia was the result. Like a goldfish in a glass left out in the sun, entire species of animals suffocated because of this. These conditions also promoted the development of anaerobic bacteria, which only thrive in oxygen-depleted environments. Instead of oxygen, these bacteria produced hydrogen sulfide, a highly toxic gas that poisoned the water. Initially, these effects were limited to the shallow coastal waters, but as, due to the warming of the polar regions, the ocean currents were disrupted, the entire ocean was affected. What remained of the largest ocean in history was a stale, toxic, oxygen-depleted graveyard. In the end, the volcanism in Siberia had transformed the planet from an oasis of life into the largest mass grave in history. Within only 60,000 years, the global animal population had decreased by more than 99.9%. 95% of all species in the ocean and 75% of all species on land died out. The end-Permian extinction was the biggest extinction in Earth's history, and the only one that almost wiped out all land plants and also severely affected insects. It would take life on Earth almost 10 million years to fully recover from this catastrophe. But while the formation of this so-called large igneous province had brought complex life to the brink of extinction, it was also a new beginning for the few animals that survived. Like an evolutionary reset button, it had reshuffled the deck and gave those species that had managed to fight through the inferno the unique opportunity to conquer the Earth. With an area of maybe more than 4 million square kilometers and a volume of around 3 to 4 million cubic kilometers, that's enough lava to cover all of today's land area with a layer of rock 10 meters or 32 feet thick, the province in Siberia, also called the Siberian Traps, is definitely one of the largest of these provinces, but it's certainly not the only one. Large igneous provinces are defined as magmatic plateaus that span over 100,000 square kilometers or more and have a volume of at least 100,000 cubic kilometers. By that definition, we know at least 40 of these provinces from the last 550 million years alone, of which about a dozen probably exceeded the definition by at least tenfold. Of course, erosion and tectonic processes have in most cases weathered away or destroyed a lot of it, making estimations of their original extent challenging. But the fact that you can still see the astonishing remnants of these eruptions today, in some cases hundreds of millions of years after their formation, speaks to the scale of these eruptions. We can divide large igneous provinces into continental and oceanic provinces. Our record of oceanic ones is, however, limited, because as opposed to continental plates, the oceanic crust is constantly getting recycled by tectonic processes and is therefore, with rare exceptions, nowhere older than 180 million years. The most notable of the oceanic provinces is probably the Great Ontong Java Plateau in the Southwest Pacific. It consists of a series of provinces that, during their formation 120 million years ago, probably made up one enormous plateau. Here, over an area the size of Australia, the largest lava eruption in the last couple hundred million years took place. Over the course of 7 million years, a total of 80 million cubic kilometers of basaltic lavas were expelled. That's enough lava to bury the entire United States under 10 kilometers or 6 miles of molten rock. On land we have, aside from the Siberian Traps, for instance, the Central Atlantic Magmatic Province that formed 201 million years ago in the center of Pangaea, before the subsequent breakup of the supercontinent scattered it across three of today's continents. Its original extent is estimated to have covered between 7 to 11 million square kilometers, making it, in terms of area, the largest of the continental provinces. In Asia, we can also find the remnants of the Deccan Traps, an up to 2 kilometer thick province that once covered half of modern India. It formed 66 million years ago at the end of the Cretaceous period. The North Atlantic Igneous Province in Europe is between 55 and 60 million years old, and was later broken up by the opening of the North Atlantic Ocean. With an original volume 2 to 3 times larger than that of the Siberian Traps, it is perhaps the most voluminous continental province. At last, we have the Columbia River Basalt Group, a comparably small, large igneous province in the western United States. Only between 17 to 6 million years old, it is one of the youngest and best studied provinces on Earth. Today, its remnants stretch across 4 states, cover an area of 160,000 square kilometers or 60,000 square miles, and reach a thickness of roughly 1.8 kilometers or 1.1 miles. Of course, these are only a few of the dozens of provinces that we know of. Considering the devastation the Siberian Traps caused, it's perhaps interesting to examine what impact the formation of some of the other mentioned provinces had on the planet. What causes these catastrophic lava eruptions also remains to be answered. All of this will be part of the second video on flood basalts.